given a seat. Distance may divide, but Christ's promise unites those bounded by time, those blessed by eternity. Let heaven be glad.
Let the whole earth bow before you.
Heaven is here, and earth, and the church above and below is one. Peter is here, and Paul, Martha, and Mary. Francis and Teresa, Sojourner Truth and Jonathan Daniels. The saints from far back and those who left us not long ago, and only sight prevents us from seeing them, one with us on the other side. Let heaven be glad.
Let the whole earth cry glory.
Heaven is here, and earth, and the God who made them. The Lamb, glorious on the throne, sits beside us. The Spirit of God, the Dove, makes her resting place among us. God inhales the breath of our prayers and spreads the table for our satisfaction. Let heaven be glad.
Let the whole earth cry glory.
Blessing and honor and glory and power be to our God forever and ever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also
with you. Let us
pray.
Almighty God, the fountain of all wisdom, you know our necessities before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Have compassion on our weakness and mercifully give us those things which for our unworthiness we dare not. With you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Now, when the king was settled in his house, and the Lord had given him rest from all his enemies around him, the king said to the prophet Nathan, "See now, I am living in a house of cedar, but the ark of God stays in a tent." Nathan said to the king, "Go, do all that you have in mind, for the Lord is with you." But that same night, word of the Lord came to Nathan, "Go and tell my servant David, thus says the Lord, are you the one to build me a house to live in? I have not lived in a house since the day I brought up the people of Israel from Egypt to this day. I have been moving about in a tent and a tabernacle. Wherever I have moved about among all the people of Israel, did I ever speak a word with any of the tribal leaders of Israel, whom I commanded to shepherd my people Israel, saying, why have you not built me a house of cedar? Now, therefore, thus you shall say to my servant David, thus says the Lord of hosts, I took you from the pasture and following the sheep to be prince over my people Israel. And I have been with you wherever you went, and have cut off all your enemies from before you. And I will make for you a great name, like the name of the great ones of the earth. And I will appoint a place for my people Israel, and I will plant them, so that they may live in their own place and be disturbed no more. And evildoers shall afflict them no more, as formerly, from the time that I appointed judges over my people Israel. And I will give you rest from all your enemies. Moreover, the Lord declares to you that the Lord will make you a house. When your days are fulfilled and you lie down with your ancestors, I will raise up your offspring after you, who shall come forth from your body, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build a house for my name, and I will establish the throne of his kingdom forever. I will be a father to him, and he shall be a son to me. The word of the Lord.
Let's read together that portion of
reading from Ephesians. Remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. Remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh, he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off, and peace to those who were near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. The word of the Lord.
gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord and this summer, though, we're also following another set of stories which you have heard week after week from the Old Testament.
not that David is to build him a house, but that he will make a house for all eternity out of the lineage of David. And so at the end of today's reading, David is on the one hand humble because he's been brought up short that his plans are not God's plans. On the other hand, he's also filled with thanksgiving for the gift of the house that God has planned to give him. So that story has to do with the plans and how they are juxtaposed or intersect with the plans that God makes. And we can hear even in the song that we heard this morning that God does have a plan working through David for all time. But it's not the plan that David follows. On the other story that we're hearing in the Gospel is this story of the disciples traveling with Jesus. And today, you recall a few weeks ago, they were sent out into the countryside and he said, go out and heal the sick, drive out the demons, preach the kingdom of God as a man. And so they went out two by two, and today they come back. And they come back, we can imagine, filled with energy. They've been successful. Some successful beyond their imaginations in terms of healing and people listening. But they've also encountered opposition. And over and over again, that's the passage you remember about you go to a town and somebody welcomes you, stay there. And if they don't, then wipe the dust off your feet and leave the town. That's what they've experienced. And they come back now to meet with Jesus and to find out now, after their experience, what the plan is for them. What are we going to do next? So Jesus says, come away with me and to a quiet place and we can rest and talk. But on the way to the quiet place, the big crowd goes around the edge of the lake. And when they get to this place, Jesus sees the crowd that's longing for his healing touch. And he goes off and starts his healing immediately. And the disciples go on to another quiet place. Then when he's done with that healing, they seem to get in the boat again, go to another side of the lake, and there's another crowd. And Jesus immediately gets off the boat and starts healing and healing and healing.
It appears that he is a compulsive healer.
And so what the disciples experience is that there, in one sense, is no plan. That the plan is Jesus. And the plan, and Jesus and his compulsive healing, is what it's about. It's not that there's a strategy that they are to enact. It's not that they have some grand scheme for bringing the kingdom of God into the world. The scheme is heal people who are at hand. The scheme is drive out evil spirits when you encounter them.
The plan is
be alive in the moment of the kingdom of God and how you can be an instrument in it.
And now.
That's how Jesus lives, and that's how he wants the disciples to be, and he wants that to be their plan.
So we have
two stories on these two parallel tracks that are running beside us as we leave our life. And one of them tells us and reminds us, that our plans are not God's plans, that very often it doesn't seem that God has a plan, but that God's intent is a firm commitment
stone. The plans that we have
may or may not be good plans, but the important thing is to be attentive to,
on the one hand,
God's promise that God will be with us for all time, and on the other hand, to the needs of those who are at hand in our own lives. For those who need our healing touch, those who need
the word, hope, comfort,
those
who need some joy brought to
them.
Those two stories come together.
Lord, in your mercy. Give them courage and hope in their troubles. Bring them the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy, we commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled. And we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom.
the joy. This is my body, which is given to you for the remembrance. supper, he took the cup of
wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sin.
Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his gracious God, send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in the sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where with all your saints we may enter. Hallelujah, Christ. Let us pray.